I'm Derrick Jensen. This is Resistance Radio on the Progressive Radio Network. My guest today is Jay Barlow. He received a BS in biology from Arizona State University and a PhD in biological oceanography from Scripps Institution of Oceanography, UCSD. He's been a researcher at the NOAA Southwest Fisheries Science Center in La Jolla, California since 1982. His research has primarily involved evaluating and mitigating human impacts on cetaceans and pinnipeds along the U.S. West Coast and in Hawaii. International work has involved surveys of cetacean abundance in the Colombian Amazon, the Yangtze River, and the Northern Gulf of California. Today we talk about vaquitas. So first off, thank you so much for your work, and second, thank you for being on the program.
Well, thank you, Derek, for dedicating your program to vaquita.
So a lot of people might not know what they are. They may never have heard of them. Can you just give us an introduction to them?
Yeah, first off, there's... It's a small porpoise, very small, only about 4.5 feet long, living only in the northern Gulf of California. And porpoise isn't a generic term. It's a very specific term for scientists. There's only 6 species of porpoise in the world, many species of dolphins. And the porpoise are the ones without any beaks and very small. And they're rather distantly related to the dolphins, but they look superficially similar.
And can you, you said there's 4 species. What are the 4 species?
There's 6 species of porpoise, and they include things like the finless porpoise in the Yangtze River, more commonly to more of the audience here, probably harbor porpoise, which are found along the both the east and west coast of the United States. And then there's some southern hemisphere species as well, and Dahl's porpoise, a flashy black and white specimen in the North Pacific.
And so the vaquita are among the most endangered species on the planet. They're very, very rare. Can you talk about – well, let's back up a little bit. Prior to conquest – were they ever common? What was their original range? Can you talk about their historical abundance or lack?
Well, if we go way back in history, they probably evolved from Burmeister's porpoise, which is one of those porpoise species found in South America about 1 million years ago. And so at one point, the range of porpoises included all of the coastline from Peru, say, up to the Gulf of California, and then further on with different species. But then things warmed up and they were separated and they contracted into a very small area in the northern Gulf of California. And so we know they're only in about 1,000 or so square miles at any time in history. And given a really high density of animals, of 6 animals per square mile, we'd probably expect that there would only have been maybe 6,000 animals at the most in recent history, and you know since the area was colonized.
And what do they tell us about their lives? First off, let's talk about their eating, and then second, and life and length of life, reproduction, all that, and then next, are they social or not?
Yeah, they're very general eaters. They'll eat anything that's the right size. So they'll eat small fishes, crustaceans, stuff from the sea bottom, mostly those small schooling pelagic fishes. They live to be maybe 20 years old, and they can only produce 1 calf every year at best, but more typically 1 calf every 2 years, and the females don't mature until about 6 years old. So they're relatively slow at reproducing. They can probably at best do maybe 5% to 10% growth rate per year in the best of conditions.
And they, I guess the next thing is to, are they... talk about their numbers and the change in numbers over the trends over the last 30, 20, 10, 5 years.
Yeah. They were only identified as a separate species Very recently. So they were found by biologists in the 1950s based on strandings along the beach there in Mexico. And as soon as they were discovered, they were discovered to be vulnerable to fishing nets. The fishing nets that they're most vulnerable to are gill nets. And starting in the 1950s and with the advent of monofilament gill net, more and more gill net was used to catch fish and eventually shrimp in the northern Gulf of California. And as that happened, their numbers shrank. So we don't know what the starting numbers were. We didn't do any surveys until the early 1990s. But at the earliest time that we had done some surveys, they were already down to the low hundreds of animals, say 500 animals for the entire species. And that's after two decades of heavy fishing. So we can only speculate, but certainly they were a lot more abundant than that. Well, they continued to decline with additional fishing effort and additional ways of fishing. They're actually using gill nets to catch shrimp in the northern Gulf of California. It's been, not a method that's used very many other places in the world, but it was something that could be used effectively from small boats. And so as they developed more and more ways to catch fish, they accidentally discovered more and more ways to kill the vaquita. The last estimate that was made of their abundance that was made published was an estimate about 97 animals left at the last year.
I want to talk about that. I mean, that's just horrifying and makes me really sad. Before we talk about how horrible this is, a question I've wanted to ask is we talked a moment about gill nets. I want to talk about them more in a moment, but does the fact that the Colorado River no longer reaches the ocean has to have had tremendous harmful effects on the Gulf of California in general? So A, can you talk about that briefly? And B, has that affected the vaquita?
Certainly there have been great changes in the Gulf of California with the loss of the Colorado River input. And there will be future changes as well. We don't, though, think that is affecting the vaquita. They've never been tied to freshwater inputs. And the real driver of productivity, the engine that drives productivity in the northern Gulf of California, are the tremendous tidal currents. The tides there can be almost 10 meters, 30 feet between the difference between high tide and low tide. And these are some of the greatest tides anywhere in the world. And all that tidal energy is converted to currents, which upwell deep, highly nutrient-rich water to the surface, where there's an abundance of sunlight. So productivity in the northern Gulf has not been impacted by the loss of the Colorado River. The nutrients are coming up from deep. They're not coming from river inputs, and the river inputs were always a trivial component of the productivity there. The vaquita that we see, almost all of the females have calves with them, and both the females and the calves are very fat and round. So there certainly seems to be no lack of food constraining their growth. It's just the mortality side of the equation.
So can we talk a little bit more about the Gulf of California? Because I actually don't know that much about it. I'm guessing that a lot of other people don't either, because it's so long and skinny that this, just on completely superficial, ignorant response, it seems like that it would end up being, that this kind of surprises me, that there is nutrient-rich water comes up from the depths. Is it actually quite deep?
It is. If you imagine the San Andreas Fault that goes through San Francisco and you extended that down all the way to Mexico, that would be the Gulf of California. It's where the fault is splitting off, and the western half of California and all of Baja California is on one plate headed to the the northwest, and the rest of the world is on another plate. And because this is a dividing center, the waters in between are very deep, up to, I think some of the basins are approaching a mile deep, certainly a kilometer deep. And so that leaves, you know, lots of flow. And because it's sort of a dead end box canyon, the tides, which sort of wrap around the coast and come up from the south, barrel up the Gulf of California in a big bolus, and then cause these enormous tides, similar to the Bay of Fundy on the east coast, where we also have really hot enormous tides.
And you know, sorry to stray away from the Vaquita, but I'm also this really fascinates me. And what are the what are some of the unique features then of I live in Crescent City, California, which is on the north coast, and we, you know, the tide here can be several feet, and I know what tide pools and what the intertidal zone looks like here, but what happens when you have a 30-foot intertidal zone? Are there other unique features independent of the Vaquita that have to do with that 30-foot intertidal zone?
Well, you certainly have a very rich intertidal community, but it's mostly mudflat. So when the tide goes out, it can go out almost a mile in distance in some of those areas. And so you can, you know, that exposes an enormous tide flats where there's a lot of shellfish activity, snails and other mud dwelling things. Not beautiful tide pools for the most part until you get to the more rocky parts of the mid Gulf of California. And there you have some you have lower tides, but you also have some beautiful rocks right next to the ocean. It looks like if you've ever sailed there, it's like sailing in the bottom of the Grand Canyon. It's really spectacular. As you get further north, it gets the country around the Gulf gets very flat, and that's why you have such the tidal range is not only high vertically but also horizontally.
So let's go back to the Vaquita, and I hate to use this utilitarian language, but what are some of their ecological functions? You know, like one of the things that bears do, one of the many things bears do, is they will eat the salmon at the stream and then they poop it out further in the forest. They move nutrients around like that. And I was just interviewing somebody about grizzly bears who was talking about the importance of grizzly bears for distributing grass seeds and how they really increase plant biodiversity. So, or we can talk about wolves when they came back into Yellowstone, they would drive herbivores away from streams, and so they actually improve trout habitat quite a bit. So, what are some of the interactions between Vaquita and their larger communities?
Well, I wish I could make a better case for the importance of Vaquita to the human existence, but sadly.
I don't care about human existence so much as the natural really, community.
Yeah, they are a top predator there. They're one of the, along with bottlenose dolphins, they're the most abundant marine mammal. Well, there's the California sea lions as well. So those three would be the most abundant marine mammals in that area, and they'd be responsible for feeding on a lot of fish resources, which moves nutrients from the surface to the bottom and feeds the bottom community. But the sad fact and the reason why, you know, it's really so hard to make a case for little species like Vaquita is that no one's livelihood would really be impacted if they were to disappear completely. There's no ecotourism built around them. They're just one of many consumers in the northern Gulf of California, and they're not keystone species like the sea otter or the grizzly bear might be in other areas. So it's really hard to make the case that they should be saved from purely utilitarian needs.
Oh, I want to be really clear. When I was saying utilitarian, I was not meaning human utilitarian. I was talking about their role in the natural, in the ecosystem, in the natural community.
Okay, I understand.
So you said that one of the problems you talked. Let's talk more about gill nets. Is a lot of this fishing legal or illegal? And what is being done to attempt to protect them from either illegal or illegal fishing?
Well, things are changing very fast in Mexico, and for the better. And I'll describe a little bit about that in a few minutes. But first, let me tell you the situation up until earlier this year. And that was that there was really a wild frontier of illegal, semi-legal, and legal fishing in the northern Gulf of California, with very little enforcement. The gill netting for shrimp was legal, but what was legal was just 600 feet of net, and in fact, most of the fishermen were fishing 2,000 feet of net. That was not legal. There was a legal fishery for finfish, but they were taking an endangered species. There's an enormous fish there whose history is tied up with the history of the vaquita. It's called the totuaba, and it's nearly as long. And actually, it can be longer than the vaquita. It can be 6 feet long, and weigh up to 150 pounds, 200 pounds. This fish was caught in gill nets and caught by dynamiting in any other way that you can possibly catch a fish, until it was endangered by the mid-70s. And it was given total protection. It was listed in both the U.S. and Mexico as an endangered species. And then for a long period of time, nobody heard much about the totuaba. Finally, it started to make a comeback. And the illegal fishing for this endangered species made an enormous comeback, mostly because, for some odd reason, its swim bladders are prized for a soup in, guess where, China. And the soup is so valued as for its medicinal purposes that an individual fish swim bladder was worth $6,000 to the fishermen, and you can just imagine what it's selling for in China. And so there was an enormous burst of illegal fishing that started about 4 years ago that's really been driving the extinction of the vaquita. So we have two endangered species. The near extirpation of one driving the extinction of the other, because of the valuable swim bladder. What's changed is that Mexico announced in December of last year that they were going to close the northern Gulf, the entire range of vaquita, to all gillnet fishing. And that ban on gillnet fishing just went into place in early June. And the reports that I've heard in the last month or two is that the military, Mexican Navy, has been called in to actually enforce this ban, and that they're doing a very good job. There's very little illegal fishing that's going on. There have been a number of busts of illegal fishing for the totuaba, and so that they're intercepting the illegal fishing, and the total amount of fishing pressure has gone down tremendously. So this is a two-year interim measure and is one of the largest conservation measures, not only in Mexico, but anywhere in the world. The compensations paid to the fishermen is estimated to be $37 million in U.S. dollars per year for this two-year ban on all gillnet fishing in the area. And that was calculated as what you'd actually have to compensate the fishermen to compensate for the losses of fishing activity in this one area.
Wow, I'm sorry, but that's actually a policy that makes sense. It sounds like it's actually working. This is this is great news, right?
It is fantastic news. The question is, how long are they going to be able to maintain it? Because as I was saying, given their life history, the vaquita is not going to bound back like a fish population could. If the fish produces a million eggs, the growth rate of fish population would be much, much greater than a vaquita population. Of the 100 or so animals that are left, there are probably only 25 mature females, and each produces one calf every 2 years. So we're talking about a very, very slow growth rate. And so the ban on fishing has to be made permanent. And until that happens, they're really not out of the woods. But we're very encouraged by this initial development by the government of Mexico.
And how are the local people responding to that? Are they happy because they're getting that compensation, or do they hate the vaquita? Are they resentful? Is there voluntary cooperation now that they're getting paid, or as well as the Navy being there?
They're grateful for the compensation. It's certainly well received, and the fishermen think that it's fair. And the reason we can tell that is that the fishermen on the opposite side of the Gulf of California, near another small fishing village called Puerto Peñasco, are now complaining that they're not being paid not to fish. So we can tell that the compensation is fair, because in fact other fishermen want to get in on it. I think that the attitude is fairly pragmatic among the fishermen. I think they expect the enforcement to be at high levels for a short period of time, and I wouldn't be at all surprised if some fishermen intend to commence fishing as soon as the vigilance is slacked off to any degree. So it's going to be a battle to keep that enforcement in place, and then to make the ban on gillnet fishing permanent.
And what are, if the gillnet threat is removed, and let's pretend for a moment that it were removed permanently, are there other significant threats to them that also need to be dealt with, apart from their low reproduction rate?
No, I think that there's no barriers to their recovery. I worked on another very sad endangered marine mammal survey. It was for the Yangtze River dolphin, and I was just a few years too late, because we did a complete survey of the Yangtze River and found none. We declared the species extinct, the first significant marine mammal extinction due to man since the Steller sea cow in the 1800s. So, but there the comparison is that they had everything going against them. There was illegal fishing, and they were being caught in all manner of fishing nets. There was massive pollution. There was river traffic that was looked like the I-5 freeway on a busy day in Los Angeles. There is just no way that a dolphin could live in that river for any length of time. The situation is different in Mexico. And fortunately, there's really only one thing that's holding them back, and that's the bycatch in gillnet fishing.
How are the other dolphins doing? I'm sorry, the other porpoises doing that you mentioned?
The other porpoises worldwide, there are hot spots of trouble. There's harbor porpoises in the Black Sea and in the Baltic Sea, and both of those populations are very small. There's a finless porpoise in the Yangtze River, and it's struggling. It's declining in abundance and is now thought to be less than 1,000 animals left in that population. So the ones that occur in highly populated areas next to coastlines are not doing so well. Those in the U.S. seem to be doing just fine. The rules and regulations governing the bycatch and marine mammals and fisheries seem to be working in the U.S.
So I have another question about Vaquito, which is, given that their numbers are down to perhaps less than 100, and what did you say, 20, 25 mature females, are we going to run into a problem of inbreeding depression, or do you think that they'll be okay with that?
They're going to be more resistant to inbreeding depression than a lot of species. So if you have a large population and you suddenly reduce them to very small numbers, you have a lot of deleterious genes that can end up being lumped together in the same individual, and that's what inbreeding depression is. So you get a compounding of effects when you have a small population. But if the population has always been relatively small, then you have relatively little genetic diversity, and fortunately that means little in the way of deleterious genes. So they're naturally a little bit resistant to the small population effect because they've always been kind of small. But the best way to avoid inbreeding depression is to allow the population to recover at its maximum possible rate. And if we can secure the bands in gillnet fishing, then we might have a chance of doing that. We're not seeing any signs of inbreeding depression. They seem to be reproducing just fine so far.
So talk a little bit more about the creature themselves. I'm kind of curious. I mean, honestly, when I've seen pictures of them, they seem really cute. And sorry to use such unscientific language, but do you find them actually endearing personally?
They're adorable. I've got several pictures of them in my office here that I'm looking at. So let me describe to the listeners. They're sort of a glossy silvery color, but they've got a black circle around their eye, and they have this black outline around their lips. Looks almost like lipstick and mascara. They have a darkish colored dorsal fin, and it's just a very strikingly colored animal. It's much prettier than our harbor porpoise in California, I tell you.
So you say that the program here is for 2 years, a 2-year ban, and what will it take for that ban to be continued? Is this pretty capricious, or is there a decent chance that it will continue? And what can anybody do to attempt to help make it last?
Well, it's really on the government of Mexico to make it last. We can apply a certain amount of pressure internationally, but it's going to be to the government of Mexico to enforce the fishing regulations and to make them permanent. There is planned for this fall a big survey to try to estimate, using visual sighting methods, how many vaquita are really left. I think that the government of Mexico may be waiting for the results of that survey before making any definitive statements about whether the gillnet ban is going to be permanent, because they want to make a big politically potentially unpopular and expensive statement like that, banning gill netting, they want to make sure that there's enough vaquita left that they can really survive and repopulate. And I think that may be difficult. The ship survey is going to be, I think it's almost 70 days long on a big U.S. research vessel. They're going to have multiple teams of observers searching from the high positions on this 150-foot research vessel, and they're going to be doing the transect lines in that area multiple times to try to do as complete an enumeration as possible.
And I was reading somewhere that sometimes they can be hard to survey. Is that accurate? I was reading somewhere that they don't always stay near the surface, and maybe I'm completely confused.
No, you're right. All of the porpoises are kind of hard to survey. They surface without any conspicuous splashes. They just sort of do a little roll at the surface. If they're facing away from you or towards you, you don't have a dorsal fin to see. It's very hard to spot them. The group sizes, you asked me about social behavior earlier, and I forgot to answer, but they're not very social. The group sizes are usually just singletons and pairs. Occasionally, you'll see three of them together. Most of the pairs are females with their calves. So they're not very social. You don't have very big target to see. And especially for vaquita, they seem to avoid ships. There's a lot of shrimp trawling that's been done in the area, and they probably learn to associate ship noise with danger. And so they start avoiding the ships at a mile range. And if they move just half a mile off the transect line of the ship, they can be completely missed. So I'm actually going to be participating on the second half of that survey. And on the survey, we'll be using giant 25 power binoculars that are mounted on pedestals so that we can see the vaquita at ranges before they react to the vessel.
Do you enjoy doing surveys like that? That seems – I love asking different activists what – like I was working once with a wetland specialist, and he was digging in the soil and then rubbing the soil between his fingertips, and the color of the soil would help him determine if this was wetland soil or not, and then would have greater protection. And I said, do you get off on doing this? And he started laughing and said, yeah, this is my second favorite thing to do after playing with my dogs. And likewise, I asked an environmental attorney one time, so do you like doing this sort of legal writing? And she's like, oh, yeah, I love this. And, you know, I've written, 20-some books, and I love trying to figure out the relationship between perceived entitlement, exploitation, and atrocity or something. I get off on that. And, I mean, I love everything you're saying, but I have to tell you, standing there with binoculars trying to search for some creature that I may not see for 6 hours or for however long would drive me crazy. I think I'd be terrible at it. Is this something that you wouldn't – is that a thing you enjoy doing?
Oh, absolutely. It's what we live for. I'm a sort of a hybrid between a field biologist and a quantitative mathematical type biologist. So I go to the field, collect the data, but I also – enjoy doing the analyses afterwards. And of the two, I far prefer standing on the deck of the ship in rolling seas, looking for the glimmer of the sunlight off of a dorsal fin of an animal that I might not see for hours or sometimes days at a time. The rewards, though, are not just in the animals you're seeking, because you'll see lots of other things as well. There's abundant bird life, a lot of in the northern Gulf of California. There's abundant California sea lions and bottlenose dolphins, tersiops, and we've even seen blue whales and humpback whales in the far northern Gulf of California. So there's lots of other stuff to see. We saw a leatherback sea turtle one year. And I think that the people that stay doing field work in marine mammal biology are people whose brain is strangely triggered by the rare event thing, and they can live off of that and search with dedication and focus for long periods of time for that small reward.
Well, I think, yeah, and like I said, I've thought about this a lot. And the good news about all this is that, you know, we need all of our gifts to, you know, we need people doing the wetland specialist work. We need people doing the legal work. We need people who are standing on the bow of the ship, which that part sounds pretty fun. It's just the notion of looking for hours. I would be just afraid that, you know, the one time that my attention really fails and I, you know, look over and chat with somebody is the moment when I would have been there.
Yeah. You learn to focus. I think it's a lot like learning to read. Once you're reading a book, the first few sentences, maybe you'll pay attention to the individual words, but then pretty soon your brain just becomes fused with the book, and you're just not even reading the individual words, but you're gleaning the meaning. And I think that looking at the sea when you're searching for something is very similar. You're just reading the surface of the ocean for any signs of something that's different, and it becomes very natural. And you can't do it with focus for a very long period of time. We typically rotate our observers into a different position every 2 hours. But for 2 hours, you can focus like that.
So a different direction to go. And if you're not comfortable with this, we don't have to go this direction. But so many activists have said that being aware of what's going on to the natural world is to always be living in a world of wounds and to be dealing with this pain and sorrow all the time. And you mentioned the survey that was completely, that was tragic over in the Yangtze River. And what do you do with your sorrow and grief around that?
Well, what I did after, a lot of us were pretty depressed after the Yangtze expedition. But what many of us did afterwards was say we have to redouble our efforts on Vaquita. We have to make sure this doesn't happen again. And I'm not sure that we've been successful in that. I'm not sure that in the end we will be successful. And I don't know what it'll be like to have another loss the magnitude of losing the Yangtze River dolphin. I'm sure that I'd be depressed after that too, but I'd probably not give up, because I think that giving up is self-fulfilling.
Well, of course, absolutely. It's the only way, the way we know that we're going to lose is to not try. And if there's a 1/1,000,000th of a 1% chance that our work makes any difference, we got to do it. So I want to go back to this ban, and I wasn't quite clear. Is the ban primarily to protect the, how do you say it, Tatuaba? Or is it primarily to protect the Vaquita? And is the Vaquita just lucky that the Tatuaba is there to be protected too for commercial reasons?
No, the primary reason is for the Vaquita itself. The realization that there were only 100 left and that Mexico was going to lose an endemic species had a lot of impact on the Minister of Environment in Mexico and on his close friend, the president. And so I think that it really was the loss of the Vaquita. The Tatuaba, we don't know what its current status is, but it looks like the numbers are still high enough to support a commercial fishery. It's harder to drive a marine fish extinct because of their reproductive potential. So it's really the Vaquita that's most at issue. They do want to control the illegal fishing on Tatuaba, and there's a lot of efforts, even outside the range of Vaquita, to intercept illegal fishing. There are a lot of people that focused on that, because if that could become something that was sustainable rather than boom and bust, then that would be good for the people in the area as well.
So that's actually great news, because when you were talking about this before, you said that it's a 2-year ban, and then I misunderstood, and I thought that if the Tatuaba recovered, then they might release it, if it's simply to protect the Tatuaba. So this is actually potentially good news in terms of making this ban permanent.
Yeah, I think it is. Mexico is hosting a big international workshop on biodiversity in La Paz, or Cabo, I've forgotten which, this coming year. And I think that they would like to, they certainly don't want to lose a species immediately before that. But I think it'd be a great opportunity for them to announce a permanent ban on fishing. And hopefully we can, on the survey, find enough Vaquita to justify that.
And were most of the illegal fishermen local, or were they also from all over the world? At $6,000 a pop, you'd think they'd be all over the world.
No, the fishing was actually very local, and there were smuggling networks that you'd have to be linked into to ever get that kind of price for a fish. The fishermen primarily live in the one of three fishing communities in the northern Gulf of California. Some illegal fishermen come to the area from further south in Mexico. They drive up in their pongas, or their pongas get trailered up to the area. Pongas are small 20 to 25 foot fishing vessels, open vessels with outboard motors. So that's the sort of the scale of the fishing that's going on now. It's not big commercial boats. It's small, sometimes termed artisanal fisheries.
And this is a bit afield, but how did they determine who gets paid and how much they get paid?
That was based on how much they had legally landed in the past several years. And one of the inequities is that the money went to the permit holder. So when the fish is landed, the total landings are counted against the permit holder, who isn't necessarily the guy in the boat. And so the permit holders are going to be collecting the vast majority of this compensation. And how they distribute that to the crew, I think, is one of the big uncertainties that is yet to be resolved. Or maybe it's resolved and we'll just have to see how it pans out. But a lot of the money is going to the wealthier of the fishermen, and the crew may be getting the short shrift here.
So we have about 4 or 5 minutes left, and I want to finish in a minute by asking sort of a wrap-up question about Vaquita. But before then, are there other creatures whom you are attending to right now that you would like to make people aware of? Are there others that you're doing surveys of who are having a really hard time, or others that are doing really well? Is there anybody else you want to talk about?
Well, the main area where I work is on the U.S. West Coast, and we just completed a big ship survey, 4 months long, last December. And the news is mostly good. And I think that we have to have these good news stories to keep us going sometimes. But we found more of one species of common dolphin, the short-beaked common dolphin, than it ever been seen in this area before. The large whales, including blue whales, fin whales, and humpback whales, continue to be in really high numbers. And I think the message is that if you control the bycatch and other human impacts, as has happened in much of the U.S., these populations can thrive, and we can have a strong, healthy fishery, and we can have robust ecotourism, and they can coexist side by side, and we can have it all. But it really needs a level of top-down control that's sometimes hard to achieve, especially in developing countries.
So, two questions left. One is, what would you say to some, say, 18, 19, 20-year-old who loves the natural world and is really excited by the idea of doing these surveys, obviously not right now, but what would you suggest to a young person? How could they position themselves to be able to do that for a living?
Well, in field biology, it's very competitive. You might think that it'd be a relatively rare thing to do, but a lot of people find that it's very, very satisfying. And in order to get jobs in it, you generally will have to volunteer first. You have to consider that that's part of your education. You pay to go to school. You're going to have to volunteer and take unpaid positions in order to get the experience that'll give you a real job, because certainly they don't teach these skills in colleges. They'll teach you other good skills, and hopefully you'll learn how to write and analyze data, but they won't teach you field biologist skills. And there's really no other substitute to getting those skills other than going out in the field and doing it. And nobody's going to hire you unless you've already done it before.
Well, and that's okay anyway, because that's, A, you'd be doing a really great thing, you'd be doing a good thing for the natural world, and you'd be doing presumably what you love. So,
absolutely.
So the last question is, it sounds like, so give me a, let's pretend it's 5, 6, 7 years from now, or 10 years from now, and give me a reasonable best case scenario for what, for the vaquita population and general health.
Best case scenario is the fishermen have all converted to other means of catching fish, and the population of vaquita has doubled. That we, if in best case scenario, in 10 years we could have 200 vaquita, and we have acoustic monitoring tools that would allow us to detect that level of change, and I think that that's still in the realm of possibilities, and I'd love to see it happen.
Well, thank you so much, and thank you very much for your work. And I would like to thank listeners for listening. My guest today has been Jay Barlow. This is Derrick Jensen for Resistance Radio on the Progressive Radio Network.